Welcome back to this tutorial. Let's just continue off from where we stopped in the previous one. Let's just do this because we're gonna need more than one terminal here. And let's put this one like this. I already have another root terminal open. Let's just put it here. Ah, come on. I don't know, I'm a perfectionist with these things. Don't ask me why. Let's just put this one down. Like this. Why? Why are you doing this to me? Okay, there we go. So now we have our setup where you're gonna need two terminals. So just go ahead and open them, two root terminals. And down below I have a small set of commands, so I don't have to remember them while I do this. Anyway, the first thing that we're going to use is, well, in my brilliant ordering of things, the last one here. So let's just go ahead and copy that, paste it here, and let me just go over this command. So you have MSF payload, you have specified which one do you want, you have a host. Listening host, this is your own IP address, and it's being redirected to root desktop, and then I have named it cmd.exe, but you can name it whatever you want. You can smash your keyboard and it can be anything. You can put your name, last name there if you want. Anyway, you would hit enter here. I'm just gonna go ahead and change this name because I've already generated it. Let's say cmd101. Press enter, and this is gonna run for a while. It's a virtual machine, so give it a break. Understand it, that it doesn't have, that it does not possess a significant amount of resources, and it says, okay, created by MSF payload L host, and this is the path where it's gonna be created, so we know that it's on the desktop somewhere. Yep, there we go. So I have the old one, but I have the new one here. This is the CMD underline 01.exe. You can't actually run this file on Linux without Wine, but we don't actually want to run it on Linux. It doesn't make any difference. Now this file you can copy on your USB drive and you can carry it around in order to infect the intended target, or you can actually force the download by, I don't know, pretending as it is it's an upgrade feature for web browser or something of a kind. Once you have the command of somebody's DNS, of your intended target's DNS, we can pretty much redirect them anywhere and do whatever you want. They can't do anything unless you approve it. So have this. Once you have this, you can utilize it pretty much anywhere. Will it be detected or not? That is another issue indeed. Sometimes it will, sometimes it won't, depending on the system and its upgrade. So this will work for Windows systems. I think it's going to work universally across pretty much all of them. But don't hold my word to it. I have tested it out on Windows 8.1. It does work there. Does it work on 7? Probably. Does it work on anything below 7? I don't know, but very likely, like 90% chance. Anyway, let's just bring this back. So now that we have generated the payload, let us assume that we have delivered it to the victim machine. As I said, just use the previous tutorials and there you will find, there you can combine any of those techniques to pretty much deliver this to pretty much any machine out there, as long as you can either redirect their traffic through you by creating an evil twin of a Wi-Fi, or by messing around with their DNS settings, poisoning their traffic, etc. Poisoning the ARP, etc. Anyway, I already have it copied out onto my Windows 8.1 virtual machine. And I'm going to go ahead and clear this screen because I don't think we're going to be needing it anymore. Here, I'm going to type in use. So tab option is supported here. You can finish your commands with tab. Multi-handler. Press enter. And then you type in, you can actually type in show options. This is going to show you the options for it, but not much here. Clear, set payload. Nope, not like that. Set payload. Yes, actually, exactly like that. Set payload. Windows. Okay. The tab can be a bit slow in a virtual machine, but if you're using a physical machine, this is going to go a lot faster. Meterpreter. Reverse TCP. So you remember all those payloads that we've seen in search? With search? Well, this is just one of them. Anyway, press enter. Excellent. So payload is set. Now let us configure it. You can type in show options. There we go. So you have localhost. This is what you need to configure. Listening host. And you can configure the listening port. The default is 444. You can leave it, honestly, if you're not using it for something else, but you can also change it. Here's how you would do it. So set L host, and ifconfig, I want to see the IP address. So it's 102, clear, show options. Oh wow, my keyboard skill is amazing, right? Anyway, now that we have this, I just want to keep the screen up there so you can see the options. Just type in set, very simple, plain English language. What you want to set host to listen on, set L host, and that is going to be 192.168.1.102. This can also be your external IP address, your public IP address. As I've said in the previous tutorial, you just need to configure the DMZ on your router. That is different from one router to the next, but it's just one option. You absolutely have to have a DMZ on a router. It's always there. If you don't know how to do it in your particular router, I mean, go log into it, look for it. If you really can't find it, type in your model number in the net and type in how to set the DMZ for this model. You should be prompted with a large supply of legit answers. Anyway, set listening host set. Maybe not listening host, as it says up there the listening address, but host needs to have an address. Anyway, the same thing you would do for port if you wanted to change it. So set L port, and then you would type in some number here, which would reflect the port that you wish to listen on. I'm just going to leave the default. I don't really see any reason to change it. Keep in mind that this port, that the L port needs to be the same as the... Actually, no, it doesn't need to be the same. You can just leave it like that, but also it can be set here. Doesn't matter. Yeah, you would actually be able to set it here as well. If you set it here, then it needs to be the same as here, but if you didn't, you can just leave it as it is. No problems, no need to conduct any changes there. Depends how you use and configure these commands. Then you need some options or don't need some options, etc. But I just decided to go at it this way. So we've configured the host, and I'm gonna go ahead and clear the screen. Show options. I want to confirm that I have set it, and there you go. So it says L host, and then there's an IP address. I prefer clearing up the screen, but if you prefer to see the stuff that you have configured and then run some commands, feel free to do that as well. You don't need to clear the screen as much as I do. Anyway, type in exploit. Press enter. It says started reverse handler on 192.168.1.102: this is the port, and starting the payload handler. Okay, now where is my Windows machine? So now I'm here in my Windows machine, and this is the script. So cmd.exe. Basically, you can name it whatever you want. You can present it as whatever you want. There are many other ones, like DLLs and stuff of a kind. You can see it with a search command. Feel free to explore further on that, and I do encourage you to explore there and to discover many more options that Metasploit has to offer, because if I was to make a detailed overview of Metasploit, that would probably I would probably need to make like three courses, and I still wouldn't cover half of the options in there. But anyway, try new things and ask whatever you feel like in the discussions. I will be more than happy to help you out with anything related to this. It doesn't necessarily need to be in the tutorials. It can be something outside of the tutorials. Regarding Metasploit or something of a kind, because it is a rather large framework, so if you need help with it, just post it there. I will be glad to help you out in any way that I can. Anyway, go ahead and start this. Run standard. This is a standard question that is pretty much asked for any application. Do you want to run it? Go back to the Kali box, and there you go. The meterpreter session has actually started indeed. So, what do we want to do here? Show UUID, is that it? Nope. UUID, is this the one? Upload, no. Show. Oh well, doesn't matter. I can. When you enter the meterpreter session, things tend to change a little bit. But you can just type in shell. And there we go. So channel 1 created, Microsoft Windows, Microsoft All Rights Received. What I wanted to show you previously to this is the ID of the computer that we have seized, how it is marked, but doesn't really matter. You can when you can get you it's a username. I do believe it's a username. But it doesn't really matter, as I said. You can just go in here and you can see that we are in C users creator desktop. And if I go, I can MK there, and let's see, can you, nope, can you see me? Okay, there, can you see me? Let's go back to our Windows machine. Where is it? Excellent, there it is. So there's a folder in it. It says, "Can you see me?" Fantastic. Oof, yeah, my music in the back. Where is it? Where is it? Come on. Kali, there we go. So I'm guessing that the power off is not gonna work, but let's try it anyway. Power off is not recognized. Okay, so shut down. Okay, so you see what the problem is here that I have encountered. Immediately, you're using one operating system, and you've just been prompted with a command line of another operating system. That can be problematic. Why? Because those two command lines are completely different. Let's try reboot. No, it won't actually run. Let's try help. Let's try help shut down. And I get more options that I really wanted here, but let's go, let's go. We need to, this is a simulated scenario, and we need to actually, it's clear? No, it's not. In Windows, it's CLS. But it doesn't clear the current screen, so that's kind of weird. So you see, Meterpreter shell is not exactly what you expected it to be. But you still have a full access to the machine that a current user has that has ran the script. Now, in addition to this, you can apply some other scripts if you want to run them as well. You can run whatever you want, just make a file or something of a kind and do whatever you want. Let's go Notepad. Again, my music. Excellent, so we have Notepad that has started here, which is rather interesting. And yeah, this is not what you want at all. Let's see if this is, let's see if the something, let's see if another trick will work. Note. I can, oh, okay, I can do this. Echo, anybody there? Then I can reroute that to, I don't know, blah dot txt. Excellent. And now I would need to type in notepad. The tab doesn't work here. Blah dot txt, which is very annoying. And now you've successfully started blah dot txt. And excellent, there's another notepad file. It says anybody there. So imagine this is just kind of popping here and it says anybody there. Let's see if we can figure out how to shut the computer down with a shutdown command. Oh, there are so many options. Help shut down usage. Oh, there are a lot of arguments here. Display graphical user interface. No, I don't want that. Log off. Okay, so power failure environment, cord unplugged. I'm not sure if I want those. Let's see. Shut down. Slash, oops. Slash B. There we go. It actually worked. Meterpreter session one closed. Reason died. Basically, the computer on the other side died, and you can see in VirtualBox. Yep. I can't actually open it now. It's being bugged out because it is actually stopping. So, Kali, it says Windows 8.1. It says powered off. How amazing is that? You can just shut the computer down. There we go. So it's no longer there. Okay, so to tell you one thing, this would be an extremely stupid thing to do, what I just did. Before I have made my script persistent, before I have scheduled it to run at boot time, I have shut down the computer on the other side. What now? Nothing. You have to redo the process again. You have to hack back in or wait until somebody's a genius. A genius on the other side actually decides to click on that file for like no reason of whatsoever. And you generally wouldn't put that on desktop. I've just put it there as an example, but you can put it anywhere you like. Doesn't matter if they download it from the net. It's gonna go into their downloads folder, but doesn't matter. As long as they run it, it's gonna be fantastic. And once again, you do have a way of deploying this because you do have a way of directing the traffic of your intended target. Anyway, I bid you farewell, and I hope to see you in the follow-up tutorial where we shall expand upon this further.